hear me? Okay, great. Well, thank you everyone for attending this presentation. Is this mic okay? Okay. First of all, you may, if you have the printed copy of the program guide, you might realize I am not Rob Center. Rob Center could not be with us this weekend, so I'm actually going to need to rely a little bit on some notes because I don't do this on a regular basis. But my name is Katina Dana, and I first learned about the Northern Forest Canoe Trail in 2010 right here at Canoecopia, and I might very well have been sitting in one of the seats that one of you are in today. And I was so inspired by what I saw, and just I immediately started planning how I was going to do this trip and who I was going to be able to recruit to get me through the entire 740 miles. I have since been back every year, with the exception of last year when I was hiking the Appalachian Trail and visiting as a section paddler, which is probably how most people would actually approach the trail. And so this way I'm going to be your tour guide on a really whirlwind overview of the Northern Forest Canoe Trail, and looking at some bed and breakfast, lodging options, and what kind of water we're going to encounter. Mack Turex is a, I should mention, I did it in 53 days in a Minnesota 2 Kevlar canoe. Mack Turex is going to join me at the end of the presentation. He is a speed demon and went after the fastest known record, did it in 22 days and a couple hours in his kayak. So with that, I will take you on to a little bit about the trail. So first of all, I'm curious about a show of hands. How many people are kayakers? How many are canoers? Any stand-up paddlers? All right. Well, the trail is accessible to all kinds of paddlers, including stand-up. It also attracts wildlife lovers and those who enjoy history, and it is accessible. Many parts of the trail are suitable for families with young children and novice paddlers alike. And with destinations from mile to wild, there is something for everyone. So where is the Northern Forest Canoe Trail? It is located in the northeast United States. It begins in the Adirondacks in upstate New York and New York State. Goes up into Vermont, you hit up Quebec a little bit, drop down in New Hampshire, and then half the trail is into the state of Maine, ending at Fort Kent at the top. NFCT inspires people. It calls a sense of adventure, a sense to immerse yourself in the natural world, and to test personal limits. Those who travel its waters, whether it be for a month or even just a day, can experience the beauty, the joy, the challenge, and the incredible hospitality of the people and the communities that this trail strings together. So before we go too far into what the water bodies actually are all about, there's a couple stats to share with you. And these have changed over the years. The trail was actually founded in, or finally created in 2001, so it's only a 16-year-old trail. And they keep adding water bodies occasionally and improved portages, maybe add a portage or two. So first of all, we have 23 rivers and streams. There are 62 lakes and ponds. There are 3 national wildlife refuges and 2 designated national wild and scenic rivers. And regarding accessibility and infrastructure, the route is signed with more than 600 trail markers. There are 182 access points, more than 450 campsites, and these include state parks, NFCT developed campsites. There are a few Adirondack shelters along the way, and there are also a few private campgrounds, one of which has a swimming pool in it. And there are 77 portages, but don't let that scare you too much. Most are built to avoid hazards like waterfalls and around dams. There are a couple also that are there as options for people who are not as comfortable running class 2 and above whitewater. And there are, I wanted to talk about the wheels too. Many of the portages follow roadways and are kind of significant duration, might be a mile or more. And because they're flat, they're able to be wheeled. And I come from a boundary waters canoe background, and wheels were never on my radar until I was reading up about the trail, and all these paddler blogs were, a lot of them were talking about whether or not a portage is wheelable or not. So wheels are definitely possible and preferred in some cases. The trail connects 45 towns and communities. And these range in size from the city of Plattsburgh with a population of 20,000 to even something as small as a general store that's located on a remote portage up in Maine and isn't even included on this list. But most of the towns consist of a couple hundred to a couple thousand people, and they offer things like a convenience store for sure, a grocery store, there might be a restaurant or two, and sometimes some lodging options. There are informational kiosks and signs throughout the trail. There are sign-in boxes are present. And then the organization is, the stewardship part of the organization is charged with overseeing this grand adventure. So in addition to trail maintainers, we offer summer waterway work trips and hire seasonal interns. Sign-in box registers are replenished, lowdowns are removed, outhouses are erected, portages are built, and people just have a really good time preserving and improving the trail. Like, that's a good time right there, moving those rocks. Yeah. The trail is detailed in a series of 13 waterproof maps. And these navigational maps are similar in scale to the Fisher and McKenzie maps that some of you might be familiar with on the Boundary Waters, but they include additional information such as portages, points of interest. There might be historical notes about legends in the area, and there's also publication listings about other related materials that you can read about. Most people now choose to enjoy the NFCT by paddling just a section of it. And this means, though, that you can potentially choose your optimum water levels and maybe even the best weather when to plan your trips. It also means that you can paddle the entire trail downstream as a sectional paddler. As a through paddler, you would start normally, well, every through paddler today has started in Old Forge and then ends in Fort Kent, Maine, and that includes 162 miles of upstream paddling. And you can see how the trail is detailed into, if they're not all at one place. the maps are in these 13 divisions, and each map covers about 40 to 77 miles per map. Other resources available include Paddling Through Time, which is a historical account of the trail, the official guidebook, the Northern Forest Canoe Trail, and I did neglect to point out that the trail not only changed my life, it turned me into a writer. So I created a Through Paddler Companion guidebook because all of the maps are written in a downstream direction, and as a through paddler going upstream, you have to keep reversing what you're reading in the maps. My book also is more technical, so I include information about all the portages and whether or not they're wheelable, since now that's kind of an important thing. And the middle book is more of an overview. It has more history and the points of interest and some side trips too that a through paddler wouldn't necessarily choose to do. The NFCT maintains a large website, which is currently in the process of being revamped. This is what the new one's going to look like. If you go to the website today, it's a little different, but the same information, and there's a lot of information in it, is housed in the website. So pretty soon it will look like this. So now it's time to take a look at the water. It ranges from mild water to wild water. And I'm now going to break the trail down actually into four sections. And our first section is going to be the New York, which covers maps 1, 2, and 3. And the major water bodies are the Fulton Chain of Lakes, the Racket River, the Saranac Lake area, and the Saranac River. The trail officially begins in Old Forge, New York, and this is the western terminus. But you definitely do not have to start there. You can start at any point along the trail. But maps 1 and 2 actually offer a pretty good introduction to the trail. You have a variety of waterways you can sample, as well as a variety of lengths of portages, and their communities are evenly spaced out all along the trail. So for this reason, we'll start with our first destination of the Adirondacks. The Adirondacks offer a lot of interesting little historical points, like this lighthouse that you pass by. There's fabulous examples of lakeside camps and boathouses, think on Golden Pond. There is classic Adirondack architecture and historical resorts. And there's a variety of places to stay. In some sections, you can paddle from inn to inn or motel. And even for some of us, perhaps pub to pub. And the next slide shows, this is our canoe moored at a waterside restaurant. Now, I missed this on my through paddle, so as a section paddler revisiting the area, I'm slowing down a little bit and taking a little bit more time to enjoy some of these amenities. So while parts of the trail can actually not be considered true wilderness, most of the scenery there is spectacular. And this is Middle Saranac Lake. Brown's Track is up next. This is at the end of a 1.3 mile long portage, and the entire portage is not planked like this, but it is mostly wheelable. This is the area too, if some of you might be familiar with the Adirondack Canoe Classic, and it's the 90 mile canoe race that's held there every, I think, third weekend in September. It follows the same section of the trail here. This is an example of one of several of the New York State parks with our paddle access or water access only campsites. And this one has lean-tos and then a variety of tent sites. This is close up a little bit of the lean-to. They're all built by the CCC. Forkett Lake is another one of these lakes with these paddle access only campsites. And they also have a canoe livery. It's pronounced Forkett. This is the Raquette River. This is a shot of our missing presenter, a much younger Rob Center with his wife Kay Henry. And I'm not sure if everyone realizes, but Bob and Kay are the original founders of and managing partners of Mad River Canoe Company. And they are also the co-founders of the Northern Forest Canoe Trail. There's a few more shots now that you'd see in the Adirondack section, and this is on map 2. Buttermilk Falls, and you got ponds like this. This is, and they're called ponds, but they're like lakes. It's Stony Pond, and there's a historic Indian carry there. This is Lower Saranac Lake. It's one of the three Saranac lakes that I would consider jewels that are strung together by the Saranac River and the Raquette River. This is a day use area where the people are sitting there. And all around this lake are, again, water access only campsites, and there's signs. So it's like going to a regular campground with your car. You just kind of pull in to your assigned number of campsites. And then another reason why I recommend this as a good introduction to the trail is because of two sets of hand-operated locks that are positioned on the Saranac River. And they're historical, and you paddle in, and then you paddle out. So from Old Forge to Saranac Lake, the distance is it's 85.5 miles, and for most people that's about a five-day canoe trip of canoe paddling and portaging. And so that's for this reason, maps 1 and 2 really give you a nice introduction. Now, Saranac Lake is an example of a community that has bed and breakfast, groceries, restaurants, a variety of motels, and there's 2 access points, and they're all within walking distance of the town, or of the takeout. And then the Saranac River from there passes through the town, and it runs by actually an outfitter, St. Regis, is on the river left there. Many of the communities either have outfitters, or there's people that will provide shuttle services, so you can easily, for the most part, you can easily hop on and off the trail at any point. Maine is a little bit of the exception since it's so big and it's a wilder area. And then from the Saranac River, from Saranac, gets a little bit wilder, and it becomes a more working river, and it's peppered with a variety of dams, including Union Falls Dam. This is definitely a mandatory portage. Yeah. And then from here, the river is pretty much class 2 and beyond, and it starts to get a little more technical. It ends up flowing through the city of Plattsburgh, so there's a little bit of urban paddling there, and then that ends up, the mouth of the river is on Lake Champlain. So from the next section we'll cover, the second section is Vermont and Quebec, and this is maps 4, 5, and 6. And it includes the Missisquoi River and Wildlife Refuge. It goes up into Canada there for a little bit, Lake Memphremagog, took me a whole long time to learn how to pronounce all these words, the Clyde River and the Nauhegan River. And Lake Champlain, at least for me, if you're familiar with Door County at all, it had the definite feeling of Door County with the clear water, and then there are miles of shorelines, and it, we even share the Niagara limestone escarpment. It's geology that runs through this area as well. And there are similar tourism-based kind of businesses like general stores, bakeries, more pubs, waterside inns, and motels. So you probably already know that Lake Champlain is the sixth largest freshwater lake in the United States behind the Great Lakes. And the NFCT shares this area with the Lake Champlain Paddler Trails, and that trail has developed additional lakeside campsites and island campsites. And on this day, I was paddling with another through paddler that paddled a couple years after me, Peter McFarland, in the Cedar Strip canoe, and his wife Vivica. This day was very mild for a really big lake, but this day they definitely can whip up wind and turn into a really wild lake. And I included these photos too because Peter's not only a through paddler, he's also the local trail maintainer for the area. They live in Vermont. And he is a boat builder. So he built this Cedar Strip handcrafted canoe. And I wanted to point out that there's no perfect boat that, as a through paddler, that's suitable for paddling the entire distance of the trail. But boats like his, and kayaks and canoes of all types, have successfully been through paddling. And that's one advantage that a sectional paddler would have over a through paddler, is that you have more of the ability to swap out boats depending on the water conditions and where you're paddling, assuming you have access to them. So this is the first of our three wildlife refuges. This is the Missisquoi, just off at the top of Lake Champlain near the Canadian border. It can be combined actually with the next destination I'm going to share with you, or on Lake Champlain. And it's a 600 acre wetland habitat, and it offers opportunities to see more than 200 species of birds, including nesting bald eagles, osprey, and these great blue herons. And there's a rookery up here that has at least 300 nests, and it's only accessible by boat. Then the Missisquoi River. I'm pausing a little bit on this one because this is a really great illustration of the NFCT stewardship and economic partnerships. The trail passes through six towns or villages along the river here, and it is also home to one of the best bed and breakfasts along the entire trail. The infrastructure that's been developed includes the portages that are built around dams and rapids, and just as importantly in this section, the trails that are the campsites that have been developed through landowner use agreements. There's no public land, or there might be like one little strip of it. So the only way to develop camping things is to work with local landowners to be able to develop those sites. And for most of the trail, there's campsite opportunities every 8 to 10 or 12 miles or someplace to stay. So the entire trail, you have an opportunity to travel it as a journey. You can easily paddle the length of this trail that was recently also designated as a National Wild and Scenic River in 2014 over the course of a few days going downstream, because the way I'm presenting this presentation is still in the direction of a through paddler going from west to east. So, but you definitely do not have to do this. As a through paddler, this is a 70 plus mile river. You'd be going upstream, the first of the big stretches of upstream paddling. The river ranges from the mild waters found in the delta to the refuge, and then to the occasional class 1-2 whitewater. And there's some ledges along the way, a little bit of fun. And it's also very wild. This is Richford, Vermont. This is up at the near the Canadian border, about 5 miles from it. And along this entire trail, then you can either camp along exposed riverside gravel bars, or at one of the seven developed NFCT campsites. So this is what it would look like. The interns have built the floating bridges, and there's sometimes a picnic table, and there's usually a composting toilet, and then they can see how they're marked that way. And these are all free, so all the NFCT sites are free.
First come, first serve,
yep. Yeah, and so far, because the trail is so young, there hasn't been a lot of competition for the sites. And we're a friendly group. I think if a bunch of through paddlers or whoever would show up, I'll be like, yeah, fit, come on in.
I just wanted to ask, are there like
outside of me, just other than common sense within the confines of a physical site itself?
For the most part, no. The question was, are there any limits to the number of people that can camp? These are not large campsites. Some of them have room for more than one tent for sure. But there's only a couple of them that have to be, they're more private, and you actually only know about them as an NFCT member. So, but yeah, right now that's not really not an issue. I think that'd be something they will, it'd be a good problem to have if there's that many people. But yeah, right now they're usually pretty room, and these are all riverside, so there's room spread out on them. And hopefully we'll have some time at the end for some questions and answers too. I'm trying to make sure I leave some time for that. Another really cool thing about this particular section of the trail is actually the Missisquoi Valley Rails Trail follows it for 20 miles. And judging by the look of this photo, which I was given, it's been around at least since the 80s. And I also want to include it because check out Jay's Peak in the background there. We don't have that kind of scenery around here. So you're in a mountain valley. And then I use this portage as actually, this trail as a portage option in 2011. When I paddled with my friend, the river was too low, or we were tracking upstream, and then rapids were really getting rocky. So we bugged out and we jumped on the trail. And this, fortunately, we didn't know it at the time, but it's in my guidebook now. There is an awesome, it's a John Deere themed restaurant and pub, and it had water, which I needed at that point. So I stopped there, and then the other thing this trail passes is an ice cream stand, but in Vermont they're called Creamies, and it's actually, I think it's ice cream and pizza now. So both the bike trail and the NFCT deposits you in front of this place. This is the Gray Gables awesome bed breakfast. This is Mack with our friend Russ. Now Russ is a trail supporter who lives about only 5 miles away from Richford, and he frequently helps out paddlers, sometimes in need, sometimes he just looks for them. He also has sectionally paddled the entire trail. He just finished last year after 20 years. So he predates actually the whole creation of the trail when it was formally done. He figures he used about 19 boats in the process, and this is where the sectional paddler definitely has an advantage over a through paddler. So I thought some of you, at least the people who raised their hands being canoers, might be interested in what his list was about. Now, Russ is strictly a canoeist, so you won't find any kayaks or stand-up paddle boards on here for sure. And you'll observe that he borrowed actually many of his canoes that he, or boats that he used. And he also borrowed his, at that time, his mother's brand new black graphite Northwood wind canoe. Yeah. Which I have one of those, so I love it. Warlex canoes and plastic molded canoes might be the better choice for some of the rockier and boulder strewn rivers, whereas a Kevlar canoe would be easier to portage on some of the longer parts of the trail with the longer portages. So having said that though, most kayaks and canoes can be used in the entire trail, as I had said earlier. And the only one I would personally not recommend would be a sea kayak, because the fragile fiberglass hulls would be pretty susceptible to being damaged on those boulders through rivers. And the length of them too, there's at least one river that's extremely serpentine, and just maneuvering around that. You can, Mack's done it. So, but it takes a little more effort there. And then another reason, of course, why we all love the bed and breakfast there is their breakfast.
Did you gain weight?
I lost weight. Oh. Yeah, no. Oh, yeah. This is actually Mack's photo, so I don't know if that's breakfast there on the left or not. But I've been to the Richford Bed and Breakfast now at least 3 or 4 times, and sometimes when I just went back to visit too, we stopped in there. And I've met through paddlers too that happened to be there, like coincidentally. So that has been pretty cool. So. Next up is Canada. They're still in the second section here. This is the Missisquoi River. It settles down a little bit more at the border. And the biggest draw about Mansonville, in addition to some of the historic buildings that are present there, are another fabulous bakery. So yeah, eating my way through. The other thing about this is they speak French up in this part of Canada. It's like you're in another country, so it's pretty fun. And also, if you're lucky, you might be able to see the glimpse the elusive Canadian heifer. This section also does go through some agricultural and pasture lands, so I just wanted to point that out too. It's not all exactly wild, undeveloped shorelines. There's definitely development in parts of the trail. And this is the Grand Portage. This is the longest official portage on the entire trail at 5.7 miles. And it is one of those trails, again, as a sectional paddler, completely optional. As a through paddler, not so much. So the picture on the right is our friends that are wheeling. So again, you can see how wheels can be used on the flat stretches. And then the picture on the right is we're getting to the height of land. And there's a 700 or 800 foot climb here that you're walking. And then it divides what the watersheds. So the Grand Portage delivers through paddlers primarily to this next water body, the Lake Memphremagog. This is was an active bootlegger's route during Prohibition, and it stretches 25 miles long, of which the NFCT covers 12 miles of it. And then it also offers campsites like this one that was added just in 2013. This is another example of the trail stewardship and the awesome work of those summer interns. They did the fine detailing on the outhouse, includes the canoe shape and the little paddle handle. There's three or four tent platforms that they built here at this area. So I included this shot, which I considered interesting when I was paddling. This is when I was sectional paddling. And actually, I had a kayak, and it was a heavy plastic molded one at this point I had rented. And it felt like a tugboat in the water compared to the Kevlar. But what was interesting to me and why I took these pictures, if you look at the vertical line at the tip of that island, that's the U.S. border there. So the tip of the island is the U.S. I don't know why Canada wasn't able to annex it with the rest of the island. And then close up, this is what the border looks like, at least in this area. So Canada's on the left and the U.S. is on the right. So there's no border guard here, but what you do is you paddle into the city of Newport. This also has a lot of services, including an awesome co-op and really great restaurants. I guess I'm eating my way through. Well,
I'm thinking you had to fast before you started the trip.
No, unfortunately, no. When you report into customs here, what it is actually a video phone. So they see you, but we don't see them. Then the next section out of Newport is a 30-mile section of the Clyde River. This is a small, wilder river, and it's mild waters and wild waters. Out of Newport, this is also one of these rivers you would be ascending as a through paddler, going upstream. So this is the first section. There's some rapids in here. You have to track or portage. Well, most people end up portaging around because it actually gets a lot wilder as you're going further upstream here. But the reason that I'm pointing out the Clyde too is it has a really unique feature. It's notable for the fen. And you may know the fen is a boggy wetland area with communities of rare plants. And then there's many streams flow into here and backwater, so it's like paddling into a maze. It has osprey nests with ospreys. And there's other birds. And just a really interesting area to be paddling through. And then there's this guy. Beavers are found all along the trail, not just in the Clyde, but they are most notable for their handiwork due to these gut things. Yeah. You have to go going upstream over several or more of them, depending on the water levels. On the source of the Clyde River begins in picturesque Island Pond, Vermont. And the river actually passes beneath this building. This is what is a hotel. That black rectangle in the middle there, that is the river. Next, please. There we go. That's the same kayak I took on Lake Memphremagog too. So one more river we're going to check out is the Nalhegan. Paddlers have an opportunity to actually travel the entire 15 miles length of this river, but only with the appropriate river and whitewater paddling skills. Nalhegan is another one of those unique ecosystems. It's full of wildlife and wildflowers, and there's native trout here, and there's great birding. And this section is totally suitable for novice paddlers. There's a lot of beaver dams in here, but this one you're going downstream on, not upstream. And then the second, or the, oh, it passes through the second wildlife refuge, the Silvio Conte Wildlife Refuge near the New Hampshire border. But from the visitor center, the water becomes quite wild. And this is a section that you definitely require expert paddling skills in order to be able to continue on. And there's actually a waterfall that's just beyond here, which I didn't do. You have to actually ferry across like a 75-yard pool and then portage around the waterfall. Next area in New Hampshire is actually our smallest map. It's contained on just map 7, the whole thing. It's mostly about river paddling. It's the Connecticut River, the Upper Aminusic, and the Androscoggin. And these rivers vary in degrees of difficulty, but none of these are nearly as technical or at technical as compared to the Lower Mohegan. So the NFCT then shares on the Connecticut River has a paddling trail as well, and we share some of the same campsites and amenities there. There's a lot of sandbars, there's lots of wildlife, and the day and a half I paddled this, I saw deer, mink, fox, osprey, beaver, ever-present geese, mergansers, ducks. this can be paddled in one day. I forgot to say too, Mack paddled the Saranac 85 in less than 5 days. He did it in 2 days. Probably did this in half a day. And also John, who's in the audience, is a faster paddler. I did this in a day and a half. So this is an overnight trip because there's campsites along this way too, or it's, you can actually do this in a whole day. The Upper Aminusic is also one of those smaller rivers. It's best paddled in spring and early summer because it can get very shallow in the late summer and fall. But the cool thing about this is you get to pass under two quintessential Vermont, or actually we're in New Hampshire now, covered bridges. There's one in Groveton. And Groveton is actually more of an industrial area. There's three dams where paper mills used to be that you have to get around, and they're not really, they're not big dams, or they're big portages, or one of them is a big dam. But they actually have torn down the paper mill that used to be there. And then Stark, New Hampshire has that white building in the background is another B&B that I stayed at. And the Upper Ammo, you're actually going upstream on that one. It's two as a through paddler, but downstream, more fun. And then the final river in the New Hampshire tour is the Androscoggin. This is just a 19-mile section of a much longer river. This one has about a dozen class 1-2 rapids on it, and they do, there's a dam at the top in Arrow, and there's scheduled releases, so this actually makes for some good rafting trips on it as well. As a through paddler, this is definitely one of those rivers you want to go downstream, but or not through that, sectional paddler, because of the rapids and stuff, it's a much more fun river to be able to descend versus up, ascend. The map 7 finishes out with Lake Umbegog that's on the main border, and it's also the site of the third wildlife refuge, which contains wildlife. So there's several nesting bald eagles in this area. This is also an opportunity where you can see moose. And you've had opportunities prior to this, but now you're starting to get into the section where you're almost guaranteed to see moose. And then finally, there's Maine. So Maine accounts for about half of the NFCT out of the 740 miles. And it's covered in the remaining 6 maps, maps 8 through 13. And everything about Maine is big. The lakes, the rivers, many of the portages, the animals, the blueberries, and some of the legends. This is a fly fishing legend, Carrie Gertrude Stevens. I always want to say Gertrude Stein, but it's Gertrude Stevens. She, in 1924, she landed a record 6-pound, 13-ounce brown trout in the area using a fly of her own design. That fly is known as the Gray Ghost for anybody who fly fishes. I do not, I'm just sharing information. She is remains apparently one of the most popular fly tires in the sporting history, and her tie, the Gray Ghost, is still used in trout and salmon fishing today. Louise Dickinson Rich, she's the author of the 1942 memoir, We Took to the Woods. and she lived here at Forest Home with her husband, who was a Maine guide. Though this remote home is listed on the National Historic Register of Places, and it's only accessible by off-road vehicles or by foot, and one of the portages, which happens to be a 3.2 mile long portage, passes by this her home. And then also in the area, during the Revolutionary War, Benedict Arnold led an ill-fated 1775 invasion of Quebec, traveling through areas that the NFCT now follows. And the Arnold Trail to Quebec was also added to the National Registry of Historic Places in 1969. Human history includes the damming of the Dead River in 1950, an era of Maine's hydroelectric power. And two communities, including the village of Flagstaff Lake, were relocated and then flooded. Ironically, Flagstaff had been taken its name from a flagstaff that pole that was erected by Benedict Arnold's men during his march to Quebec. And the foundations of some of these buildings can actually still be seen lurking in the watery shallow depths of the lake. And this is now the state's largest man-made lake. So the Appalachian Trail, this is a photo I took this summer, does parallel and intersect NFCT from Ranger Lake region past Flagstaff Lake. And when I came over the summit, one of the mountains, I actually recognized the lake. And I was like, ooh. So, this is Flagstaff Lake, seen later from the Bigelow Mountain Range that skirts it from along the AT. And all of these lakes, the Richardsons, Lake Moosluk, McGuntick, and Rangeley are all destinations in themselves, and their campsites are abundant in this area. Then the section of the trail following the Dead River. Dead River is remote and home to two of the most spectacular waterfalls. This is Long Falls, just downstream of the dam and responsible for the creation of Flagstaff Lake. And this is the impressive, this one is the 40-foot Grand Falls, also mandatory portage. I'll just quickly go through some destinations. The first is Moosehead Lake, an iconic Mount Kineo. Ancient glaciers had carved out these distinctive rhyolite cliffs, and the native peoples used the area-specific stone to create arrowheads, many of which can still be found as far back as back in the Adirondacks. That proves that there was a trade route that traveled through this area, in which this trail is following. There are sporting camps, rustic lodges, modern caverns, and public campsites all throughout the Moosehead Lake area. And the trail follows 17 miles of this 30-mile-long lake, which is the largest freshwater lake in Maine, and also the largest stretch of unimpeded water, second only to Lake Champlain. Henry David Thoreau visited the area three times, beginning with his first trip in 1846, and then he did a 350-mile canoe trip that ended in the Allegash. The Northeast Carry connects Moosehead Lake to the West Branch Penobscot River. And next photo might be how he might have gotten portage's gear. But this is the Northwest East Carry today. No horse-drawn carriages were there to greet us when we arrived. The West Branch Penobscot is another popular destination, and for 20 miles in this area, you follow the paddle strokes of Thoreau to the river's outlet of Chesuncook Lake. Along here, too, there are many, many, many campsites all along this river corridor, including this one that Thoreau was known to have camped on this very island. So note the amenities. Not only are the campsites signed and marked here and named, there's also mowed lawn. And a picnic table, and then what I find to be one of the most impressive features is they have this ridge pole so you can put your tarp on it when it's raining, which is pretty cool. All the campsites along the Penobscot and the Allegash had this, so I don't know if it's just Maine or if this is something unique just to this area. And the trail continues through Lake Chesuncook with Mount Katahdin rising in the background, and when I summited Katahdin in August with my husband, we were able to look down and see these lakes that I had paddled 5 years earlier. And then our final destination is the Allegash Wilderness Waterway. This is a 92-mile section, and it is one of the first the eight original rivers that were designated wild and scenic 50 years ago last year as part of the National Wild and Scenic Rivers Act. Malagash is the longest river segment on the entire AT. It was all downstream. To date, no one has paddled the trail in reverse because this would be the longest upstream section that you'd be doing. And paddling the entire distance for this trip is like a 7 to 10 day trip for most people. And the Allagash begins either via the mud pond carry or a nice boat launch on the south end of the lake. But if you're a through paddler, this is considered a rite of passage. And this is also the same trail that Thoreau also used back in the day. He was sporting woolens, and he did it without DEET. The Allagash is another working river. There's remnants of logging eras. They're still present. There's historical, 35 historical sites. And I'm going to have you just kind of go through the slides kind of quickly. We're running out of time. So this is just an overview of some of the things you'd see on the trail. These are, and I'll find you, this is the most crazy thing you're going to come across, though, are these two large trains that are pretty much in the middle of nowhere. And these are remnants from that era when they were shuttling or conveying logs from Eagle Lake to Chamberlain and then on to the mills in Bangor. So I'm just going to go through the... Logging is still active in Maine, though, and it is a working forest, and you can keep going to the talking soon. And on either side of that, it's only a 1 mile buffer, so it's not, in that sense, a true wilderness experience like the boundary waters might be, but it's still a spectacular finish to an epic trail. So as we go through these few last final slides, I'm going to turn it over to Mack. He's just got a few things to say, and then we got a special treat at the end that we want to share with you. The last 17 miles are the St. John River, and this is another through paddler arriving at the last terminus. And the last terminus is 700 miles or more than where you first started in Old Forge, New York. And then there's the mandatory. This is the photo that we take when you're through paddling. So I'm going to turn it over to Mack then.
Well, great. I've only got a couple of slides. I mean, she's kind of said it all. So if we go to the next slide right here. What kind of people do this? Malo was only 4 years old when he through paddled it, and Don and Marilyn were 76 years old. So if anybody in here is between 4 and 76, you would call the people that have already done it. Next slide. I learned about it 3 years ago on a Google search. I just said distance paddling. I came up with the Northern Forest Canoe Trail. That was about this time of year, and within 90 days, I had geared up and got my boat. And that center picture on the top, I used a 17-foot plastic boat, wilderness. And on the bottom left right there, my second year, because I finished it my first year in 25 days, I thought I'd use a lighter boat. I tried a Kevlar boat, and I pretty much busted that one up on the river and the rocks, so I ended up getting that bottom right boat, the plastic boat, and made my second year with about 22-day trips. So I'm kind of a fast paddler in that way. The next one is, what would be some reasons? Well, for me, there were 10 reasons of what I would kind of like the David Letterman's list. And number 10 is, it's a great way to drop a couple of pounds. Okay? Number 9, there are maps and guidebooks. I always get lost, so I like the map and guidebook concept. Number 8, trail maintainers mark and clear the trail. So, I mean, that's awesome to have somebody doing that. Number 7, no permits required. All you gotta do is show up, take your passport going into Canada. Number 6, if you're a hiker with bad knees, you can still paddle the trail. Number 5, it's an endless supply of water. That's a good thing. Number 4, you can wear the same shirt for 3 weeks and still get
caught. That is so true.
I mean, it's a guy thing, but you can, okay? Number 3, you're eating prime rib and peanut butter pie while your friends think you're back home roughing, right? Number 2, it's great training for a naked and afraid audition. And the number 1 reason, your mom likes and shares all your Facebook posts. So with that, really, after 2 years, and I just can't hardly sleep at night, I get so excited about this, and as you can see, here's our last treat that we have.